Father God, thank you for this morning. Thank you for all that you provide, all that you do. We just want to give you glory, and we ask that you bless this day. Today we have a baptism and picnic. I ask that you bless the event, and bless people all around that come to the event today and that are here in church, that they come to hear what they needed to hear and see what they needed to see, and have more faith in you today, God, and trust you with everything. In Jesus' name, amen. Why don't we stand and worship, guys? This is a good way to wake up with your mind on Jesus. Amen. Amen.
Next to you, and we're all here worshiping God this morning, so take that opportunity. Don't take it lightly. If someone needs help, share the love of Jesus. Someone down in the dumps, share the love of Jesus. Someone in deep, dark trouble, share the love of Jesus. Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. Amen? Let's worship some more.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship His holy name, sing like never before, oh my soul, I'll worship Your holy name. The sun comes up worship His holy name.
Listening to a guy who was studying the first five books of the Bible because he was looking for Jesus in those stories, and he said, man, he's really hard to find. There's no prophetic word about the Messiah coming in the first five books. And he said, but you had to really search for it, and every once in a while there would be a breakup between them failing and then God drawing them back. And how he did that was through these, like, poems that he would write to the Hebrews in between. And it made me think of that the word, bring it back to today, well, today, New Testament, 2,000 years ago, practically yesterday, when it says that you're God's new creation, because we're having baptisms today, and I don't know how many of you are here, but new creation, that word for new creation is poema. It's, you're his poem. So you were actually all the way back there in the Old Testament. As he was saying his poem, saying, you know what, there's something you fail. And so we just ask for more of him and less of us.
There's nothing like your presence here in this place, and there's nothing like your passion that steals my heart away. Oh, there's nothing like your glory falling on me. More of you and less of me.
Change my heart, oh.
Morning, God, for changed hearts. And it's our prayer that our hearts will always remain true to you. We're so blessed to have you, Lord. A God whose arm is not too short to reach down and touch us, to reach down and lift us above what we may be going through. You're a God whose ear is not too heavy to hear our cries. You're always there for us. Always. You're there through thick, you're there through thin, Lord. Your love is just so all-encompassing, and we're so grateful. Thank you, Lord, for loving us so much. We give you all the praise and all the honor this morning. In Jesus' name, amen.
Testing. Good morning. I'm here to do the morning offering for guests and visitors. We have a bowl. We have a bowl in the front and one in the back. Okay. I'd like to do a little scripture reading. This is in Luke chapter 21, verses 1 through 4. As he looked up, Jesus saw the rich putting their gifts in the temple treasury. He also saw a poor widow putting two very small copper coins. I tell you the truth, he said. This poor widow has put in more than all the others. All these people gave their gifts out of their wealth, but she, out of her poverty, put in all she had to give on, to live on. Seems like this is matters of the heart. God does not look at the external, but the internal of our heart, our intentions, our motives, and our attitudes. Let us pray. Father God, we just thank you for this day, how you have blessed us. And let us rejoice and be glad in it. And as we give our tithing and offerings right now, Lord, may we give it gladly, cheerfully, and joyously, Lord. Bless it that it will further your kingdom here on earth, Lord, for your good news to people who don't know you, Lord. And may they hear the good news and all the eternal promises that are, you know, bestowed upon us that you have given us, Lord. So bless it again. I ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
The tears that made her blind. She felt such pain. Some spoke in anger, heard folks whisper, there's no place here for her kind. Still on she came, through the shame that flushed her face, until at last she knelt before his feet. And though she spoke no words, everything she said was heard. As she poured her love for the master from her box of alabaster, and I've come to pour my praise on him, like oil from Mary's alabaster box. Don't be angry if I wash his feet with my tears and I dry them with my hair. You weren't there. To the sin that had me bound, and I spent my day poured my life without measure into a little treasure box. I thought I found, until the day when Jesus came to me and healed my soul with the wonder of His touch. So now I'm giving back to Him all the praise He's worthy of. I've been forgiven, and that's why I love Him so much. And I've come to pour my praise on Him like oil. Don't be angry if I wash His feet with my tears and dry them with my hair. My head, You are there. The night Jesus found me, You did not feel what I felt when He wrapped His loving arms around me.
Thank you so much. That's a blessing to be able to have that ministry here in our church. This time, let's go ahead and release our children for Children's Church. We've got our teachers in the back. I see some of them. I see Rondi. Is there more teachers back there? Okay, they're all back there. Great. So any children that want to go to Children's Church or anybody that would like to not listen to my boring message may go over and play with the kids in Children's Church. Good. Well, it's a great day, isn't it? It's a wonderful day. Oh, I love today. I love Sundays. I love every day in Kauai, though, don't you? Oh, we are blessed. So today is a great day, not only because it is another day in Kauai, not just because it is another Sunday, but because today we are doing baptisms too, right? Oh, this is a great day, an exciting day to be able to come together to do that. We had baptisms class last Sunday, and we had some individuals in there that are going to be baptized today at Lydgate at 11 o'clock, and it was just a great time to be able just to talk about God's plan and baptisms and just how God loves us and just giving our lives to Christ. So if you're going to be able to be there with us today at 11 o'clock, I encourage you to be there. We'll have a potluck meal. Great time of fellowship and just being able to just glorify God by welcoming some other souls that have given their lives to Jesus through their public profession and baptism. You know, today is a day where I think that we live in days like today where we feel like we don't count. Who feels like some days you just don't count? Really? Most husbands feel like they don't count. Am I right? Hey, there's times where husbands, you don't feel like you got, or if you're the middle child, you don't count, right? Well, the older child and even the younger child at times. But I think we live in times where we feel like we don't count in certain areas. And I think this is an important topic that we really should look at biblically as far as counting. I want to read to you from the book of Matthew chapter 10, verses 29 and 30. And this is what it says today. God's word says to us, "Are not two sparrows sold for a penny? Yet not one of them will fall to the ground outside your Father's care, and even the very hairs on your head are all numbered. Dear Heavenly Father, I just ask you to watch over us today as we continue worshiping you through this message. I do pray that nobody hears me directly, Lord, but they do hear you today. I simply ask you to use me to the best of my ability, Lord. Just come through me and just let people hear your voice and just fill your spirit today. Let us receive your message. It's in your Son's glorious name, Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. You know, everybody, and I do mean everybody, counts. Everybody counts. You know, your neighbors may not know your name. You may have been overlooked for that promotion at work. Maybe even your own family sits there and doesn't give you the attention that you desire or that you need. But I'm here to tell you that you matter to God. Every one of you matter to God. And that's the best thing there is. You know, that's a difficult thing to really swallow, though, isn't it? To believe that. We may say that, but to believe it is a hard thing, a hard concept to truly swallow. You know, I think after all, we sit there and we think about people and how we classify people. Because I think the world, we classify a person's worth based upon their wealth or position in life. Think about that, you know? That's what makes a person count in our eyes. You know, I can't tell you how many times I've heard stories of celebrities going to a restaurant and getting a free meal just because they're a celebrity, when in fact they could afford to probably buy the entire restaurant. But you're going to give them a free meal because, well, they're special. You know, little things like that. But thank God he doesn't see us the way we see others with our eyes. Thank God that he sees us differently. In our text this morning, Jesus is reminding us of something. He reminds us of a simple but very profound truth in Scripture. He talks about a sparrow, right? He says there's not a sparrow that falls to the ground that God is not aware of, and not even a hair on your head that he's not numbered and placed there for a purpose. Well, I've got, you know, the older I get, I've got hairs poking all over the place that I don't understand the purpose of. Man, any of you deal with that? I see hairs growing in places that I didn't know it was possible to have hair grow in or out of. It just blows my mind. And then I sit there and think, well, there's got to be a purpose that I've got hair growing out of an ear area that I've never seen. I get hairs that grow right here. Anybody else? Come on. All right, there we go. We got some people that are going to tell the truth in church today. I don't understand it, but the truth is that he's placed every hair for a reason. There's a purpose for everything, and this is another thing that we just won't understand until someday when we're called to glory to be with Jesus Christ. We'll find out the answers. But he's placed every hair on our head. He's numbered each and every one of them because we count. We count. But why? Why do we count? Have you ever asked yourself that question? Why do you count? And furthermore, why is it that the people that we don't really get along with too well, that really bother us, that we are in turmoil with, why do they count too? Everybody counts. I've asked that question many times. And I've asked God at times, why do I matter? Why do I matter? Why do I count? I've definitely asked God that question as far as a person that has many critics over the years. God, do I really count? And the answer throughout the years is always the same thing. Everybody counts, and I mean everybody. First point is that I believe that everybody counts because God made each one of us special. In the book of Psalms 139, 13 and 14, we read, "For you created my inmost being. You knit me together in my mother's womb. I praise you because I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Your works are wonderful. I know that full well." Do you know that there's nobody like you? Do you realize that? There's not anybody that is 100% like you. You are truly one of a kind. Truly, the mold was broken when God made you. That's the truth. There's no other person who has been or who will ever be created in this world that will have your same fingerprint, your identical genetic code, your exact looks, and your exact character. Not ever before or ever will be. Sure, we have twins like John Heller, You're a twin. Any other twins out here? Identical twins? Anybody? Even though it's hard to tell twins apart at times, they're still different. Now, I've never met John's brother, but I can guarantee you he's different than John. I'm sure he would agree. Nobody can take your place. You know, it's true in life that you'll go on. Life will go on without you someday. Whether you and I are here or not does not put life on hold. But the way in which God made you special and unique means that the world is going to miss out. You and I are special. We're special because we are created in the image of God. Amen. In the image of God. You know, in the book of Genesis 1:26, God says this about you. He says, "Let us make man in our image according to our likeness." In the creation story, God commanded that creation be in existence. He said, "Let there be light." Guess what? There was light. He said, "Let there be dry ground," and well, there was dry ground. But in the creation of humankind, God did not command, he consulted. You see, God moved from one who created by his authority to one who was moved by his affection. The comparison of a person's worth is not that to another person. It is to the heart of the Creator. You know, you matter to God because what God creates matters. Don't you believe that? You need to believe that because it's true. Life may have dealt each one of you some tough blows. You may have messed up royally as a parent, as a spouse, as a person for that matter. But you can be the star of possibly even America's Most Wanted in some of the things you've done. But I can assure you this morning and even tomorrow and forever, is that you do matter to God. No matter how royally you've messed up or how horrible you feel about your life or your lot or your decisions, you still matter to God. You're very special and very much loved. In the book of Isaiah 45:9, we read that, "Woe to those who quarrel with their maker. Does the clay say to the potter, 'What are you making?'" I think there's times when we've questioned, "Why have you created me this way? Why is it that I am not this way when so-and-so is this way? Why do I think the things I think? God, why did you create me the way you did?" So many times I think we have that question because we're human beings, and I suppose it's okay to question, but what's not okay is to believe the lie of Satan that we do not matter to God. That's where we start treading into really dangerous waters, and we start answering the call of Satan when we give him the power and authority over our lives, saying that we don't matter and that what God made in us is a mistake. You know, I know it's hard to believe. I still have difficulty to this day comprehending the scope of it, but it's true. You and I are created in the image of God. In other words, we look alike, we act alike, we think alike. Now, sin... Sin may be trying to separate us from God, but you still bear his mark on your very soul. You ever thought about that? His mark is on your very soul. You know, on the mainland, Build-A-Bear workshops are very big, right? I remember the kids when they were little, we'd go to Build-A-Bear workshops, and you'd go into this little Build-A-Bear workshop in the mall, and they'd make you pick out whatever stuffed animal you want, and you can put the stuffing in, you can put little things inside of it, and you really design it, all this stuff. And when you're done, you can even put your own special mark on it. Now, I can tell you all the stuffed animals that my children made. I think there was a Yoda at one time, maybe even a regular bear at one time, but all these things they made, not one of them looked like my children, but they all had a mark on their foot of my child. We knew exactly who made it and whose it belonged to. That same mark from God is on each and every one of your souls. Did you know that? Each and every one of you hold that mark. But for us to believe it and to hold it true in our lives and to exemplify that and to show that to others is a decision that you need to make. Today, that decision is being made for four individuals at Lydgate. They have accepted Jesus as Jesus has accepted them. He's always loved them. They've accepted, and they're following through with a public profession of their faith to say, look at me, I belong to him through baptism. What a wonderful example that we have today. You know, I think that everybody counts too because of God. Because he doesn't desire for any one of us to perish. This is my second point here. He doesn't desire any one of us to perish. Destruction was not in the original blueprint. Devotion was. Did you know that? Devotion. In 2 Peter 3:9, we read that the Lord is not slow in keeping his promise, as some understand slowness. Instead, he is patient with you, not wanting anyone to perish, but everyone to come to repentance. That's his desire. You know, the only reason Jesus has not returned to earth right now, I think, is because everybody counts, and there will be many left behind. You know, we're told in Scripture that everyone will hear the word of God. Everybody will have that opportunity to accept Jesus before he returns. There's a lot out there. There's a lot of work to be done. So each and every day when we wake up and we see that Jesus hasn't returned and we're still here on earth, that should excite us to a certain degree to let us know that there's more opportunities for us to minister to others. There's more work to be done. That should excite us, not to the point where we're sitting there going, oh, there's more I need to do for Jesus. I've never heard anybody do that, by the way. But we should wake up and go, oh, there's more for me to do for Jesus. So you get up and you look at those open opportunities to serve, to be a blessing, to love, to cherish, and to shine bright the light of Jesus. That's exciting. He doesn't desire anyone to perish. You know, because a place called hell, it's real. He doesn't want any one of us to perish because hell is real. You see, the reality of hell in our culture is not a hot topic of discussion these days. Too many churches won't preach the truth and reality of hell. I believe our church is very proper and correct in preaching the gospel, not just from up here, but through all the ministries that we do. We've got a church that truly loves people. We have a church that truly gives and serves and loves, and there are so many people that come together to make things happen that we think nothing about. You know, Stacy, I don't know how we do it without her. She was gone this week with surgery on her hand. She lost her sister this week, so she was out of the office. Just her out of the office for a few days, you notice things not getting done that should be getting done or that you don't know how to do or whatever. I miss her deeply this week, and we need to continue to pray for her as she is very loved by each and every one of us. But her attention to detail and what she does here is so valuable and so precious and so needed that a lot of churches don't have that. We're blessed. And that's just one example of what we have going here at Kapaa Missionary Church. But nonetheless, I gotta tell you, hell, back to topic, hell is real. It's real. It is a place of torment. It is a place of pain. It is a place that separates you completely and totally away from God. And anyone who refuses faith in him is scheduled for that trip. You know, we like to make plans. We like to be organized, I think, for the most part. We like to have tickets purchased in advance. I know one time, the first time we ever went to Disney, Stacy, my wife Stacy, had planned tickets for the whole family. Now, y'all, I've got 8 kids, okay? Back in the day, I think we had 6 of them living with us, 2 were already a house married, but we were planning tickets to Disney for everybody. We had to get an Airbnb, her parents were going, we had, oh, all this stuff going. So 1 month, she planned and she bought tickets for the airline tickets. We got part of them done, and we did this for a full year. So by the time that the trip came, everything was purchased. We didn't really notice any money that we lost. I couldn't believe that we were able to afford it. And we did. But that's how our minds work, is we plan things out accordingly. And we do things farther out in advance. We need to for success. Now, I'm telling you right now that what you're doing right now matters. You may sit there and think, you know what, I'm probably not going to die for another 10 years, 2 years, 20 years, 30 years, whatever. Truth is, you don't know when that is. But the point is, What plans are you making right now for that eternal trip that you have? Do you have a ticket that's sending you straight to hell? It's a real place. Or do you have a ticket that is being purchased through Jesus Christ, taking you to heaven? What are you doing right now really matters. I think it's difficult for us to comprehend hell, really. I know at times I've felt like I've been there, or I'm going through a certain situation or an experience in life or a feeling, but feelings and going through hard, difficult times is not the same thing, and it truly isn't. You see, Jesus himself knows what hell is like. He has knowledge of this place. He has knowledge of hell that you and I cannot understand, and I pray we don't ever truly understand and experience it. That's why he repeatedly warns us against the dangers in going there. It's like a little kid. I can't tell you how many times I've told my kids, don't do this and don't do that, and they do it anyway. And then I'm reminded, well, they don't know until they experience it themselves. I don't want to be a little kid like that with Jesus. When he tells me, don't do this, don't do that, because you're going to go here, I don't want to experience it. I want to listen to him. I want to have faith in something better. So hell is a real place, but the word perish in Scripture has a broader meaning too. To perish for eternity is to go to hell, but to perish can mean more than hell. It's a state of hopelessness, absence, a purpose of meeting gone. To perish is to never connect with what makes a person fulfilled. You know, I know people who are perishing before my very eyes, and not one of them has died and gone to hell. The crush and blows of life have robbed their soul, and they perish in despair and hopelessness. You know, among the billions and billions of people on planet, do you think that you matter to God? Do you think anybody else does? Among the billions of broken hearts and crying eyes, I believe God hears every one of them and that he's at work on our behalf for each and every one of us, because everybody counts. And I got to tell you, if everybody counts to God, if everybody matters to God, then they should matter to us as well. They should. So I believe that everybody counts because God doesn't desire for anyone to perish, but everyone counts because even though God loves us the way we are, he refuses to leave us that way. And that's my third point, is that he refuses to leave us the way we are because he loves us so very much. You know, if you're going to grow in your walk, you must be willing to allow God to help you change and to be more like Jesus. We've got to do that. It's a struggle. It is a struggle because we're human beings. We don't like change for the most part. We like to do things our way. You know, we like to have that power and that control. But when we have that power and control that we think makes us so strong and so tough, really it makes us really weak. The only way we're going to find strength in this world or in the next is through Jesus Christ. By relinquishing the control of our own individual lives, by saying we matter so much to God, he loves us so much that he's willing to grab a hold of me and change me to what he really desires me to be, not to be what I want to be. It sounds so much like the world today in different things. Could you imagine this microphone all of a sudden waking up one day, if it had a life, saying, I want to be a drum. Could this microphone ever be a drum? You identify as a drum, do you? Oh, okay. Doesn't sound too good. Doesn't work out very well, does it? That's just common sense, folks. God desires you to be something much more than what you think you are. He desires you to be a loving, compassionate person that lives for him, giving him glory today, tomorrow, and always. He desires you to be the person that he's created you to be, nothing else and nothing less, because you matter to him. We all matter to him. And if that doesn't excite you, then I don't know what else will. I want you to take a trip with me. I want you to take a trip in your imagination for a moment, okay? So I want you to muster up all of your imagination. Imagine a nice, warm, sunny Kauai day, okay? It's a beautiful day. Well, looks like it's today. And you take your child to the beach, and you're at the beach, and you're enjoying this beautiful Kauai day. You're there, you're laying on the beach, you're enjoying watching your child play in the sand and watching the waves, and you're really enjoying this moment in time. And then suddenly you hear some chatter behind you. It's some chatter that you see, and behold, what do you see? You see Wailua Shave Ice. Wailua Shave Ice all of a sudden decided to go into the food truck business. And they got a Wailua Shave Ice food truck coming down right by you. You get excited, your child gets excited. Oh, look, Shave Ice. Oh, I'd like to get some Shave Ice. That sounds really good. So you tell your child, hold on one second, I'm gonna go get us a couple of Shave Ice. So you get your money and you leave your child there and you walk over and you can still see your child, everything's safe, yeah? And you get two wonderful delights, right? Two of the best treats that you can think of on this beautiful, warm, sunny, Kauai day at the beach. And you're so thankful that Wailua has gotten into the food truck business. So you hand the man the money, you pay for the treats, and you get them and you make your way back to your little keiki playing in the sand. But as you bend down to give this delicious treat to your child, you see something. You see something in their mouth. Their mouth has sand in it. I mean, not just a little bit, a whole bunch of sand. For some reason, your keiki wanted to put sand in their mouth, and it's full. And you know, most of that sand isn't the cleanest stuff. So they've got this sand in there with other particles of you know what, and everything else is in there, in their mouth. So where you intended to put this beautiful, wonderful, great treat from Wailua Shave Ice in their mouth, it's full of this ucky, gross sand where they put. So the question is this. Do you love your child with the sand in their mouth? Do you still love them with the sand in their mouth? Well, duh, of course you do. You better, right? It's still your child. They've got some gross sand in their mouth. That's a silly question. Of course you do. You love them. They're no less your child with the sand in their mouth. But your next step is an obvious one. I think if you're a good parent, most of us would do this, I'm sure, is that you would not allow your child to sit there with that disgusting, dirty sand stuck in their mouth. You refuse to leave them that way. You refuse. So what do? You pick them up and you carry them to a nearby fountain. You wash their mouth out. Why? Well, because you love them, that's why. You love them. And you know what? This is what God does. He does the same thing for us. He holds us over the fountain, and what he says to us, he says, spit out the dirt. Spit it out. I've got something better for you. And so he cleans all the filth, all the immoral junk out of our lives, all the dishonesty, all the prejudice, all the bitterness, all the greed out of our lives. And we don't really enjoy the cleaning sometimes, do we? You know, picture your keiki washing the mouth out. They're kicking and screaming, you know. They don't know it's good for them. They don't know what you're doing. They know that you're shoving water down their mouth and you're digging it out. We go through the same thing with God, yeah? A lot of times we go through some hardships where God is really trying to clean us up and we don't want to do it. We fight and we battle and we argue. It's difficult. And we scream, I can eat dirt if I want to. Which is true. You can. But if we do, it's our loss. It's our loss. God loves us just the way you are, yes, but listen, he refuses to leave us that way, amen? He refuses to leave us that way. God tells us that we count because he loves us the way we are, but he refuses to leave us that way. God has a better offer for you. He's got something much better for you than what you're going through right now in this world. No matter how much you like to eat the dirt, no matter how much you love to live in the sin and everything else, God has got something far much sweeter and greater in mind and in store for you. The question is, are you going to receive it? Do you think you're good enough to receive it? Do you think that there's no way that God loves you enough to take that out of your life, so you're going to continue to wallow in the grossness of this world and live in the despair? Once again, that is somebody by the name of Satan causing doubt and confusion in your mind to get you to believe a lie. The truth is that God loves you, friends, every one of you. No matter what sin you have in your life right now, no matter what you've done in your past, no matter how many pains and hurts and despairs you've gone through, God loves you more than you can imagine. And if you would simply just understand a fraction of how much he loves you and give all of your life over to him and say, God, I'm done living in this life that I'm living in. I know there's something sweeter, something better than what I've got right now. And if you believe that you count to him and you matter to him and you hold your hands up to him and you say, God, please take me from all this despair, he will do it. That's the great news. That's the wonderful news. God's special message to you this hour is simple. I love you. Did you know that? God loves you. That's what he wants you to know. For many of us who have been brought up in church or in religious families, the response may be a big yawn with the phrase of, well, what else is new? They may have not heard over and over that God loves them. But because they have not received this message in its entirety, in the depths of their soul, life has taken the form of one disaster after another disaster as a result of passages like John 3:16 seem to apply to the rest of the world, but not to us in the midst of our present problems. Friends, in fact, it's a fact. We truly count to God. He sent his son into the world to die for our sins, which have prevented us from accepting the core of our being, the reality of his love. You see, every day, God does so many things to us and for us that we don't even recognize it. It's a manifestation of his love, how he cares for us. Take, for example, just the rising of the sun. If it didn't rise after a few days, all life that we know of would start to die off on the planet. Everything would die. The whole entire earth would die. God has the sun rise each and every day for you. You know, I've been really wanting to see a nice Kauai sunrise for a while. I used to go out quite a bit and see a lot of them. I'd get up early in the morning and I'd go and I'd see the sunrise and I loved it. The past couple of months or so, I've been so busy trying to get integrated with our household goods coming and with Stacy coming back on island and getting settled in our condo. I've kind of forgot about that. I forced myself the other day and I got up. I said, I'm going to go watch another sunrise. And as I went out and I saw the sunrise coming up the horizon, the ocean, every time, and I saw it again, I couldn't help but just to feel God's love that he has for us. Sometimes we get complacent in our walk, don't we? Sometimes we get very complacent. You know, I lived on Oahu for like 8 years, and when I left and I was on the mainland, I started missing Hawaii. I started realizing how beautiful and how wonderful it was. So when I moved back here to Kauai, I told myself, I'm not going to let one day pass by where I don't feel God's love and know that he loves me so much that he has blessed me to be here right now to experience the love that he has for each and every one of us. But it's easy to get complacent. For 8 years I was on Oahu, I think year 5 or 6, I started to get to where, oh yeah, look, okay, great, a waterfall, yeah. Oh, the ocean, oh, whatever. But when it's gone, you realize what you took for granted. So when I saw that sunrise, I told myself, I'm not taking another day for granted. The blessings are all around us. We need to truly see that, feel that, and believe that, because God loves us enough to give us those blessings. If you don't feel blessed today, open your eyes and see the world, see this island, see your life through a different set of eyes and realize that all the beauty around you that you haven't been realizing is a direct result of the love that he has for you. Every day he does so much for us. But even more important than that, he had his son die on that cross for us, in order that the full price of our sins might be paid for. And it might be paid for. And the reason why I say might depends upon you. It's been paid for, but have you accepted? Have you accepted that free gift? You know, when we don't accept the gift of salvation, do you realize what that is? When we refuse to receive Christ in our lives? That's us looking at the cross. And everything that Jesus did, he got beat, he got scourged, he bled, it was horrible. The torment, the pain, the torture, that's us slapping Jesus in the face and saying, you know what? Yeah, you did all that, but it doesn't matter to me. I'm not going to accept that free gift that you gave through your pain and torment. That is us in a direct violation. That is us saying, you know what? It doesn't matter to me that you did what you did. You're slapping Jesus in the face when you don't accept that free gift. As we accept the fact that's presented in Romans 5:8, says this, while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. While we were still sinners, Christ died for us. That tells me that we matter. That tells me that everybody matters. It doesn't say that he just died for a few of us, or for these people here, or those people there, for each and every one of us, black, brown, white, whatever color you are, wherever you're from, for each and every one of us, amen? He died for all of us. Guys, in closing, you matter to God this morning, amen? The people that are not here this morning matter to God. Someone this morning, I think, has been trying to fight off spiritual discouragement. You've been wondering where God is in your life. I can assure you he's here. He's talking to you right now. He's here in those whom you're sitting by. God is here, and you do matter for him. Worship team, would you go ahead and make your way back up? I also believe that someone else feels like maybe your world is falling in on you. Trust me, guys, the creator of the universe can put your world back together again. You know, we go through difficult times, each and every one of us. I can tell you story upon story of my life where I've had my lows and I've had my highs, but I think we all can do that. We could all tell stories of our lows, and perhaps you're going through a low right now. Perhaps for whatever reason, I don't know, but perhaps for whatever reason right now as you're sitting here this morning, you're in pain, and you're hurting, and you're telling yourself, and you're asking God, why am I going through what I'm going through? Do I truly matter to you? Do you even love me the way that pastor's saying you love me? How am I ever going to get out of the despair that I'm in right now and receive the full glory that you have for me? Is that even possible? Will this ever happen in my life? I'm here to tell you, yes, it can and it will. But you've got to open up your heart to him. If your heart is not open to Jesus Christ and all that he has for you, then yes, your life will be full of despair and nothing else. And those highs that we all experience, you probably won't see too many of those. You'll see more lows. And perhaps you'll be stuck in that low. Do lost people matter to you? They matter to God. Because there's not a sparrow that falls to the ground that he is not aware of, and not a hair on your head that he is not placed there. Friends, today, I feel God has spoken to a few of you. I believe that God's message is very clear and true to each and every one of us. And his message is this, and it's this only: I love you. If you haven't experienced God's love for you, if you don't believe it, if you haven't felt it, if you think that you'll never see it or never experience it, then I simply ask you to open up your heart today. Receive what he has for you. And know that you matter so much more to him than what you can ever truly imagine. Would you pray with me this morning? Dear Heavenly Father, we come before you this morning with open hearts. And I pray that as our hearts are open, Lord, we are able to receive and to really, truly realize the love that you have for us. It's all around us in everything that we do and all that we have. Lord, we do matter to you. And I pray that that is a reality to each and every one of us, that we no longer live in despair and live in doubt, and we just stop that stinking thinking and receive all that you have for us as we tell Satan to get behind us, as we receive you. As we look up, as we take your hand, as we move forward, we will see mountain high experiences because we do matter to you, each and every one of us. Lord Jesus, we love you and we just praise your name. Amen.
All right. Thank you, Pastor Kelly. Let's do this last one.
Continue on worshiping God all day together as a church family. Lydgate, baptisms will start at 11 o'clock. We have 4 baptisms today. After that, we'll have a potluck meal to enjoy and just spend a little bit of time with our church ohana, talking story, fellowshipping. Bring some chairs, bring some sunscreen, I guess. Robbie said sunscreen. Bring some sunscreen, chairs, bring a little bit of food, whatever. But we'd love to have you come join us. We'll be at the lagoons over there, the smaller one. You'll see us on the north side and all set up. So come join us. Be with us. Let's continue loving God and living aloha. Be blessed.
All right.